Hi there. In this hopefully fairly short tutorial for Blender 2.66, I'm going to go through what I've learned so far in the use of the bullet physics engine to create simple mechanical clockwork simulations like this. So if I just press play on here, you can see I've just got some balls falling, they're hitting these paddles. That's rotating this cog, which is rotating this one, which is rotating this one. It's actually not as hard as it seems at first to do. There's just a few basic concepts that you need to understand. I used it to create another simulation, which I'll show toward the end. So to start with, I'm just going to delete these items so that we can start from scratch. And I'll delete these falling objects as well. Okay. The plane I've got there as a physical object, I'm going to bring up the tools menu on the left because we're going to need that in a moment, and I'm going to add a mesh because it's a sort of clockwork simulation I'm going to make. I'm going to use the gear add-ons. These are extra objects which you can enable under properties, so under here, user preferences, you can add, there we go, add-ons. And you'll find there are extra mesh objects that you can add in there. If you don't want to do that, you can create gears from scratch yourself. So I'll add a mesh, extra objects, gear. So don't do anything to it to start with until you're happy with the form of the gear. If we look down here, I can see that I've got 24 teeth. If you want to get into gears, there are some quite complex things to understand about them, but I'll talk about them as we go through some of the very simple basics, which is as much as most of us need to know. But you can change various things such as the angle here, the width of that bevel, and the radius, and so on. So this is the overall radius of the gear. So for convenience, I'm going to set this to 2. The depth, or width as they call it, so you need that enough so that you can use it for something. And the size of the hole in the middle, which they call base. So I'm just going to have it about there. These addendum and addendum affect the teeth. So you can see that's the depth of the teeth, and then this is the depth of the bevel, really. So that's fine as it is. I don't think we want the teeth quite that big. Once you've got that somewhere reasonable, that's fine. You can then play with the gear, and these will disappear, of course, as they do with most of these sort of add-ons. So I'm going to rotate that on the x-axis 90 degrees, and we'll move it around a little bit. One of the things you need to get used to doing when using rigid body physics is to applying any scaling, or do the scaling in edit mode. And we'll come to why rotation is an important one to apply as well. So that's our basic gear. If we play that animation, nothing happens, of course, because we haven't yet made it a physical object. So if we come down to rigid body physics here, which you should see on the left hand side in the tools menu, make sure the item you want to be active is selected, and then click add active. And now when we press play, it falls onto the floor and falls over, which is fine, but obviously we want it to run on a spindle here. So there's various ways of doing this. I'm going to do it a very simple way to start with. We're going to add a cylinder. We'll go with the default settings on the cylinder. Scale it up a bit. Rotate on the x-axis 90. And I'm not even going to worry too much about having it perfectly positioned at the moment. So it's just positioned by eye at the moment. Obviously you can use locations in here to get it exactly right, and there are other ways of drawing out the central pivot as well. To make this a bit easier, I'm going to start to give things some colours. So we'll give the gear a greenish colour, and I'm just using Blender Render so that we can use GLSL shading to help with what we're doing, so that we can see what we're doing better. So I'll give this a yellowish sort of colour. So you can see it's, if I go into orthographic view, it's roughly positioned in the centre, it's not perfect. That's an attempt at a shadow, I think. Okay, that is not a physical object at the moment. If I just click play, you can see the cog or gear, whatever you want to call it, just falls straight through it. So what I now need to do is to make it an object. Now if I just make it active, obviously it'll actually go flying off, but it certainly doesn't do what we want it to do. So if I add passive, let's see what happens. It obviously affected the cog and it didn't go anywhere, but it didn't do what we might have expected it to do. The cog went flying off. Now the typical reason for that is to do with how Blender works out this influence of this shape. So if we look at rigid body collisions, the default is convex hull, and that's a better one to use if you can, but sometimes it's not ideal. However, there's the other shape as well to consider. Convex hull typically won't work very well for a complicated shape like this. So for those shapes you have to use mesh. See, now you can see it's doing much more as you would expect it to do, in that it's just dropped onto this object. This box is an active object as well, it will just fall. I'm going to place it so that it will fall onto one side of the cog. So if it's all working as expected, it would just rotate. I often use this when just checking various things. So if we just press play now, and it sort of roughly works. It basically spun and it did what we sort of expected it to do, but you notice it's not very clean, and you will find when it starts to get more complex, even if you try to enclose it by changing the shape of this spindle, it will become unstable, it will often fly off in funny directions. So this is okay for a very, very simple sort of simulation, but not so good for others. And another example of this sort of thing is if I add a torus, so that's a ring shape, and add a duplicate of it. So rotate that on the x-axis 90. So essentially it's a chain link. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to make this one passive and this one active. So in theory, this is a link. We'll just give them some colors, make them a bit easier to see, and smooth shading as well. And we'll make one red and one blue. So if we click play now, you can see that didn't do what we expected it to do. Again, some of that is down to the way the collisions are being worked out. So if we say mesh, in both cases the other one is already mesh, and we click play now. Now we get something fairly convincing, so you may be happy with that. And certainly I've attempted to make some long chains with this sort of thing, but again what tends to happen is that it becomes unstable, especially when there's more significant forces that cause this to move much more quickly. So that may be okay for some very, very simple things, but if you want to make them into more complicated systems, you need to do more than that. You need to actually add a pivot point and make them pivot from each other. So I'm going to put those to one side for a moment and get back to my gear. So how do we make this gear more stable, as if it's really fixed to that spindle on some kind of bearing? Well, what we need to do is we'll give it a couple of names first just to make it easy. So we'll call the middle spindle and we'll call the outside the cog. Cog 1. In fact, I've got a reason for calling this cog 24, because that's how many teeth are on it. With the spindle selected, we come over to here, and what we do is we add a rigid body constraint. The top object is the spindle itself. The second object is what you want to rotate around it. So select cog 24. Now this is one of the main reasons I use this little box. So let's click play and see what happens. And as you see, it didn't spin. It sort of moved a little bit, but didn't spin. Before we can go any further than that, we have to note that it defaults to fixed. Fixed is just a connection. It has a bit of flex on it, but it won't allow anything to rotate. So we're going to go for hinge, which ensures that something rotates around a point with all other axis of rotation restrained. So if we click play on that, for this purpose, this is working fine. However, you will sometimes find have to rotate the spindle that way for it to work. Now obviously it won't work now, because I'm trying to turn it the wrong way. And if that happens, just all you need to do is apply the rotation. Now, because of what I've just done, yes, it doesn't work now, so this will simulate the problem. So if I rotate on the x-axis 90, see that's spinning now. So apply the rotation and then rotate x minus 90, and you can see it spins perfectly normally. I haven't got it perfectly central, which is why it's going off slightly, and that's just, as I say, because of the fact that I haven't got it completely centrally applied. That's got the basic rotating cog, and all we need to do to connect a cog to that, we can just simply duplicate that, put another cog next to it, and put it somewhere close enough such that the teeth interfere. And as you see, it works. You notice there's a bit of resistance there, and that's down to various things such as level of friction. So each cog can have its own degree of friction, and also damping. If you want them to spin with a perfect bearing, as it were, you can put friction and damping right down. One of the other things I wanted to mention was about cogs of different sizes. It is a very complex maths related issue, but there are some very simple ideas for the ratios of cogs that you can use without getting into complex maths. So I know I've got 24 teeth on there, so if I add another gear, the default is 24, so I want 12. The reason I want 12 is because that means every one rotation of a cog with 24 teeth, if it's engaged with this cog, will rotate it twice because it's got half the number of teeth. However, what's also important is the distance between these. They need to be the same, or very similar anyway, as the teeth that they're going to engage with. And how I can achieve that is, if this cog has got half the number of teeth, it will need to be half the size, and that will then maintain the same spacing between the teeth. So the radius before was 2, so if I've now set that to 1, that should be about right to engage with this cog, and obviously ratios work the same. So you can roughly work that way. So if we have a look, I didn't put a hole in the middle, but it doesn't matter. We should be able to see that it would be a reasonable expectation that these teeth will engage, and they will, as you can see. It's a rough calculation, but it roughly works. So if I had something attached to here, every time this cog and this cog rotated once, this would rotate twice, so it would speed it up. And of course the reverse is true. So if you build a cog with 12 teeth and you want it to rotate another cog at half that speed, so to have to rotate twice, then the new cog will need to be twice the size as well as have twice the number of teeth to be able to engage properly without jamming and things like that. And that's true of the real world as well as this virtual world. So I've got a new cog here. I'm going to add a loop there. Oops. And don't really need to, but got a few problems there. So I think what I'll do is I'll, rather than this, cut this out. I'll delete this. It's because the way the cog's made, it's got its vertices all messed up. So add a new cog, gear. Everything's correct, except I need to change. There we go. Set that up there. And put that up there. Now another way to make the spindle Let me just move these out of the way. Another way to make the spindle for the middle, of course, is this way. Now, you may notice that the default cog gear is actually hollow, but of course we can just bridge, I press space bar there, we can just bridge those together. And what we can do is select all of that, shift D, scale it in slightly, again doesn't really need to be for the function, but it does for what we're going to do next. Scale in my case on the Y axis. Select all of that, press P and separate by selection. So we've now got two separate parts. We've got the spindle perfectly central on our new cog, which I'll give a colour to. Okay, let's make the cog active under our rigid body tools. Make it mesh for its collisions, make the spindle passive, and let's give it some recognizable name, spindle P1, and the cog, purple cog. So coming to here, select the spindle, add the constraint. There's the spindle, and here is the cog. I don't yet know actually whether the rotations are correct. Well, let's just give it a go. No, it doesn't look like they are. Just to be sure though, I'll move that way. The other thing you can do if you want to test something in isolation is you can move things into a different collision group. You've just got to remember to move them back again after. So let's see what happens. Yeah, I thought so. Of course, we haven't selected the hinge joint there. Right, that's okay. So let's just bring that to there. Let's put our energy source, our little box, where it's going to collide, and see what happens. And there we go. And if we reduce the friction a bit on all of these, and this is how you can control it, of course. This is all in real time. I'm not baking this first. If you have a very complex simulation, you may need to bake it. See, basically, there is a mechanical system. You've got this cog and this cog rotating once for every two rotations of that cog. And you can make things such as this. I've made a chain, I'll just briefly show you how to make that chain in a moment. And I've got a swinging weight here which engages with this cog, which engages with this one and this one. So it's the elements of a clock basically. And you can see this is baked, and I'll explain the reason in a minute. But there are no keyframes. If I select anything here, you can see there's no keyframes on any of this. This is a reactive mechanical system, which is the stored energy, and this weight is being transferred here, pulling this chain down. Friction is causing this to rotate, and this is regulating it, this is stopping it, and that's imparting a little bit of energy to this pendulum, which helps it to swing backwards and forwards. And then the overall rotation of these, this is 12 teeth on here, I think it was 24, possibly 36. Teeth on these, so these rotate much more slowly than this one. But essentially that is how an early clock mechanism works. And you can see the chains rattling around as it lowers. And I can show you basically a rendered version of that one. And you can see there It's essentially the same thing. It's running exactly the same speed. It's just that I've done a very quick render with it. That's why it's quite noisy. And obviously you can see it a little bit better with good shading on it. And the camera is going to zoom in a moment, and just very briefly you'll be able to see the thing in a little bit more detail. But you can just see the spindles there in the middle, and they don't actually need to be fixed or anything, of course, so you can see oscillating backwards and forwards there. And this one, what I wanted to show you about this one is that this is using those toruses linked together, but I'll show you how to do it so that they don't fall apart, because if you just link them together they will fall apart. And if we look a little closer on the next shot, you can actually see that these are actually pivoting sort of in the middle slightly. They're not resting up against each other completely, so that it's not simply two active objects interacting with each other, which you can do for a few objects, but things just get out of hand and it becomes unstable when you try to do a lot. So to go back to the other instance of Blender I've got here, so to talk about these rings, and in fact before I do what I'll talk about is how to make a basic chain. So I'm going to add a simple sphere, icosphere, and we're going to make a chain out of it. There are various ways to do it. I'll do a way that I commonly use. In fact, we'll move this to another layer just to make it easier to make. So first of all, we'll make this active, so we know when we press play it's just going to fall. Next thing we're going to do is we'll make sure this is sphere, because it's essentially a sphere. And then I'm going to add an array modifier. And we'll make it go vertically, so we'll set that to 0 and we'll set that to -1, -1.5. Right, and we'll set that count up a bit. I won't do too many for reasons of time. So that's duplicated our object, which is fairly straightforward. And now I'll apply it, and initially we'll have one object. So I need to select them all, go to edit mode, press P, and separate by loose parts. Now if I come back to here, where we've got a ground plane, and just press play, something strange is going to happen. And you can see they go all over the place. Even if I move them all over here a little bit, away from the other parts, you can see they just go very odd. And the reason for that is because of the way I created them, they've all got their origin up here. So, but that's easy enough to fix. We select them all, B select, or however you want to do it. Go down to Object, Transform, Origin to Geometry. Now you can see they've got their own little dots in the middle. So if we now press play, they sort of behave normally. They're a little bit on the overly stable side, and certainly if you give it a little bit of offset, they'll start to collapse pretty much as you'd expect. So how do we link those into a chain? You can select them all and just click under the rigid body tools, connect, but there are reasons why it doesn't currently seem to work so well. So the best thing to do, if you're going to make a long chain, make a small section like this and then duplicate it and join each section the way I'm going to show you. Try to remember which way round you connected. So for example, I tend to always do the upper one first, then the next one down, click connect, and you notice a little empty appears between them. And I'll explain that in a moment. Then the next one, connect, and the next one. You certainly wouldn't want to do a very long chain one at a time like this, because as you'll see there's more to do yet. So what it's done is it's created an empty in the middle, which is actually the pivot point between those two items, between those two objects. So if I press play now, even if we select them all and put a bit of a rotation on there, you notice I haven't moved the empty. In fact, I should move the empties without moving the ground plane. Notice the empties stay there, but even so it didn't do anything. It certainly didn't do what we expected it to do. it's all stuck, and that's because the default, what it has done is it's done the same thing as we did with these spindles. This is acting as a spindle, as it were, between the two of them, a connection. And it set it to the default of fix, which has got a little bit of movement in it but doesn't actually rotate. So for a chain you want it to flex in all directions, so we set that to point. So we set that for each of them. Obviously you can add these things yourself, and you can actually use an object, so one of these could be the hinge between two others, but and I haven't tried that yet, but in theory you could. So having set them all to point, I'll come back to this. Let's see what that looks like. Now it's starting to act like a chain. And in fact, if we go back to the beginning, I can actually move it around like that. So that's the essence of how you create that, the chain that I made. Now you may want to disable collisions. Disable collisions. Disable collisions obviously allows these things to go through each other. In real life, chain links wouldn't be able to do that. For a chain like this, it's probably better like that. But if you were going to create one like this, out of a lot of links like this, you may not want to have disable collisions, because you don't want them spinning and rotating through each other. So if I were to click connect there, not sure what happened there. Yes, there we go. So that's now got a link between the two of them, and you'd set that to hinge more likely. But certainly, even if you did a point, at least you would turn that off so that they couldn't spin through each other. So that's the basics of how you create the sort of clockwork mechanisms that I did. So if there's anything else you'd like to know, let me know. I'll just leave you with another view of the clockwork mechanism I made. So I hope you enjoyed that. If you did, let me know, and if you've got any questions or comments, or you'd like some other tutorials, just let me know. Thanks a lot then.